To understand the functions of the unnamed entity that we call the New World Order, it is truly the reason it's so successful in its secrecy is that it has no name. Carol Quigley referred to it as the network in his book Tragedy and Hope. In 1966, CFR archivist and Georgetown professor Carol Quigley published the epic 1,348-page Tragedy and Hope, A History of the World in Our Time. Quigley, a mentor to Bill Clinton, selected Clinton for the Rhodes Scholarship in 1968. In Quigley's third book from 1982, titled The Anglo-American Establishment, the first words read, "The Rhodes Scholarship, established by the terms of Cecil Rhodes' seventh will, are known to everyone. What is not so widely known is that Rhodes, in five previous wills, left his fortune to form a secret society which was to devote itself to the preservation and expansion of the British Empire." Paying tribute to Quigley in his 1992 Democratic National Convention acceptance speech, Bill Clinton said,
"As a teenager, I heard John Kennedy's summons to citizenship. And then, as a student at Georgetown, I heard that call clarified by a professor named Carol Quigley, who said to us that America was the greatest nation in history because our people had always believed in two things: that tomorrow can be better than today, and that every one of us has a personal, moral responsibility to make it so."
How's that for irony? Bill Clinton talking about morality. Certainly the pot calling the kettle black there. And the individualism he's speaking of, as they collectivize and homogenize society to think one way, have these very controlled choices to make, being controlled. Okay, more from Carol Quigley. Quigley's Tragedy and Hope provides a revealing look into the inner workings of what Quigley called the Anglo-American establishment. On page 950 of Tragedy and Hope, Quigley makes it known that he has no aversion to this establishment or its agenda, stating, "There does exist and has existed for a generation an international Anglophile network which operates to some extent in the way the radical right believes the communists act. In fact, this network, which we may identify as the Roundtable groups, has no aversion to cooperating with the communists or any other groups, and frequently does so." So think about that with Al-Qaeda. Think about that with the whole way that the poppy is being protected in Afghanistan, and the lies of our government. "I know of the operations of this network because I have studied it for 20 years and was permitted for 2 years in the early 1960s to examine its papers and secret records. I have no aversion to it or to most of its aims, and have, for much of my life, been close to it and to many of its instruments." On page 1247, regarding the two-party left versus right system, or the sham we call democracy, Quigley stated, "The argument that the two parties should represent opposed ideals and policies, one perhaps of the right and the other of the left, is a foolish idea acceptable only to the doctrinaire and academic thinkers. Instead, the two parties should be almost identical so that the American people can throw the rascals out at any election without leading to any profound or extreme shifts in policy." Regarding the Royal Institute for International Affairs and the Council on Foreign Relations, on page 951 through 952, Quigley states, "At the end of the war of 1914, it became clear that the organization of this system had to be greatly extended. The task was entrusted to Lionel Curtis, who established in England and each dominion a front organization to the existing local round table. This front organization, called the Royal Institute of International Affairs, had as its nucleus in each area the existing submerged roundtable group. In New York, it was known as the Council on Foreign Relations and was a front for J.P. Morgan and Company. The Council on Foreign Relations is the American branch of a society which originated in England and believes national boundaries should be obliterated and one world rule established. The New York branch was dominated by the associates of the Morgan Bank. On page 952, Quigley writes, "The New York branch was dominated by the associates of the Morgan Bank. For example, in 1928, the Council on Foreign Relations had John W. Davis as president, Paul Kravath as vice president, and a council of 13 others, which included Owen D. Young, Russell C. Levingwell, Norman Davis, Alan Dulles, former head of the CIA. On page 324 of Tragedy and Hope, Quigley states, "The powers of financial capitalism had another far-reaching aim, nothing less than to create a world system of financial control in private hands, able to dominate the political system of each country and the economy of the world as a whole. This system was to be controlled in a feudalist fashion by the central banks of the world, acting in concert by secret agreements arrived at in frequent private meetings and conferences. The apex of the system was to be the Bank for International Settlements in Basel, Switzerland, a private bank owned and controlled by the world's central banks, which were themselves private corporations. Each central bank sought to dominate its government by its ability to control treasury loans, to manipulate foreign exchanges, to influence the level of economic activity in the country, and to influence cooperative politicians." In his book, The Anglo-American Establishment, Quigley talks about the creation of the United Nations, referring to the Atlantic Charter, the basis for the UN Charter. Quigley stated, "From this point onward, the Milner Group increasingly emphasized the necessity for building up the Oceanic Bloc. In England, the basic propaganda work was done through the Round Table and Lionel Curtis, while in the U.S. it was done through the Rhodes Scholarship Organization, especially through Clarence Strait and Frank Attalot. In England, Curtis wrote a series of books and articles advocating a new federal organization built around English-speaking countries. The chief work of this nature was his Civitas Dei, which appeared in three volumes, 1934 through 1937. I'm trying very desperately to get through to as many people out there to understand why the world is the way it is and why the value of the dollar keeps going down and prices keep going up. Understanding the way the nameless society, the unnamed entity operates, known as the network, understanding the way the network works and the compartmentalization of the rings as described by Carol Quigley, who was given unprecedented access to the elite's records at the Council on Foreign Relations, who runs our State Department, basically runs our governmental policy, ladies and gentlemen. No matter what the people want, they try to get that agenda passed. It is a leftist agenda, abolishing all borders, a one world, totalitarian, socialist government. That's where we're heading. And those that are awake are like, yeah, I know. And if you're not, pay attention, Obamacare. Pay attention, the value of the dollar. And the most important thing is how the shift of the middle class is going from where we've always been, what we call Western civilization or Western culture, or you want to call it Anglo-American empire. Well, they decided to shift the funding in the 90s and started... and 70s, really. China. China is now the issue. China and India, as clearly stated.
China, talk about China might become a larger economy than the United States a lot quicker than people think. Is that the case?
That's right. Nobody seems to have picked this up. The IMF dropped a bombshell sometime, I think, in the last week, very quietly on their website, and no one seems to have picked this up. They have now put out a forecast of when the Chinese economy will overtake that of the United States. When you talk to a lot of Wall Street economists and talking heads, they will tell you, oh, it's decades away and all that stuff. Nonsense. It is 5 years' time, 2016.
But it is the world that you're going to work in. And it is not a trivial change. It is a change of monumental importance. So much so that by 2050, China and India, the two countries that I have, of course, the leading countries in the developing world, will constitute 50% of the global GDP. 50% of the global GDP. That is the consensus estimate. But let's say we're off 5%, it's 45% of the global GDP. It's nonetheless a monumental switch in terms of economic power. By 2030, the estimate now is that there will be 3 billion people in the middle class, and of that 3 billion, two-thirds of it will be in Asia. Two-thirds of it. So this is a switch from being a fraction, being less than a third, to being two-thirds. And that is a pretty dramatic shift. You'll have a middle class in China of a billion people. Billion people by 2050. Middle class. So these are not trivial changes in the outlook. These are tectonic shifts in terms of the way the planet works.
Here in America, to understand the global shift of the middle class, one simply has to look back to 1971, when Nixon took us off the gold standard. Soon after, he opened the doors to China. David Rockefeller, soon after, joined Nixon, since Nixon opened the door, and set up a Chase Bank. And they have their central banking relationship to this day. Mind you, Nixon called for a new world order. David Rockefeller called Mao Zedong one of the greatest leaders in history. A man who slaughtered 60 million of his own people. A tyrant. But we're dealing with collectivism. They love it that way. They get their monopolies to control banking, to control oil, to control energy, to control food, to control pharmaceuticals, to control all aspects of human life. This is the animal we're dealing with. And to trace the roots of the birth of this animal goes back hundreds of years. But in modern times, the modern fortune that is being utilized, and we can go back to the East India Company, British Empire, which this is connected to. It's the money powers of the British Empire, with a not for Britain any longer. The border states mean nothing. It's beyond that. They've gotten to this, let's bring the world together. And as you heard in segment one, that means poverty for the majority of the world, including the United States. To understand the plan has to go back to the seventh will of Cecil Rhodes. He had seven wills. Seventh will, he gave none of his, stated, it's on record, it's the truth, entitled, The Rhodes, It's on Record, It's the Truth. And what has happened since 1971? Well, they took us off the gold standard, our inflation, devaluation of the currency of our dollar, cheap products in China that break, that we buy, and they buy nothing from us. The trade imbalance, jobs overseas, I can go on and on. This is the New World Order, and their objective is moving towards shifting the middle class from America to China and India. That is the goal, and they're doing a damn good job of it.